I want to start with the grouping I'm most interested in. It involves Dustin Johnson. He's playing with Jordan Spieth and Martin Keimer. Is Dustin Johnson ready to be the face of golf?
Well, I hope he is. He better be ready because he's the man right now. He leads the tour in driving distance. He leads the tour in greens and regulation. He was, I think he's in the top 10 in wedge play. And, I mean, he's the man. He's embraced it, I feel. He's surrounded himself with great people. Wayne Gretzky is sort of his father-in-law. They're not, me and Pauline aren't married yet. But, you know, he's getting a lot, I'm sure, great advice from Wayne Gretzky, the great one. And I feel like he's probably observes Wayne Gretzky and has learned a lot from him. Butch Harmon's his coach. Butch Harmon won a tournament on tour. He's coached a lot of the greatest players in the game. And I think Dustin Johnson is prepared to be that guy. And, you know, not everybody embraces that. You know, I believe that one of the things that he's probably learned from Gretzky is that there's no shortcut to success. And Dustin Johnson's not come by this easily. He went to that school of hard knocks on many occasions. And but now, you know, he's become the best player. And I think that not everybody embraces that role, but he seems to want it. And he knows he's that win last year was such a great achievement coming on the heels of that just crushing defeat the year before. And I think he realized it took a lot of hard work to get there. He knows that there's no shortcut to that. Gretzky was the hardest worker and the best athlete. Dustin's probably the best athlete. And I think he just has a plan for how he's going to approach the game.
Paul, bring the microphone just a little bit closer to you.
Sorry.
Dustin Johnson, can you make the argument that he's perhaps more talented than Tiger, but far less focused than Tiger was at the height of his powers?
Well, that, I don't know. That's apples to oranges as far as I'm concerned. When Tiger showed up, he was the most mentally prepared of anybody I'd ever seen. And, you know, Tiger learned how to play golf at an early age, and he learned how to win. And, you know, my big thing now really is it's not so much what a player's thinking or what a player's trying to do through impact, but it's really how the player thinks and how they learn how to think. If you're physically smart and you know how to think, then, you know, that's a tough combo to beat. Tiger was probably, you know, almost like a military training kind of a thinker. He was almost a Navy SEALs type thinker. He had a style of just wanting to kick everybody's tail. Plus, he was the most physically gifted player. Dustin Johnson has taken a completely different path than Tiger Woods. Dustin was the second ranked amateur in the world when he came out on tour. He's won every year for 10 straight years, which is pretty good. But to compare him to Tiger is almost not even fair. I mean, Tiger Woods was something that we'll never see again. I don't feel like in my lifetime we'll ever see anything like Tiger Woods. That was the most amazing golf. He hit shots that nobody could hit. I'm sure Dustin can do that as well. But, boy, what Tiger did, I miss. I never expected Tiger's career to end so quickly. But right now it's Dustin Johnson. He's the defending champ. He's the man to beat. And for a number of reasons, he's the most confident player in the world, I'm sure. He won three times in a row leading into the Masters when, unfortunately, he slipped and fell. And we haven't seen a whole lot out of Dustin Johnson since. He did finish second a few weeks back. But it's Dustin Johnson all the way right now as far as I'm concerned.
I'm going to circle back to Tiger because we got a little time, but I want to talk about another grouping. Bubba Watson, Adam Scott, Sergio Garcia. Sergio's a guy we waited a long time for him to get that major, and now I think he's going to win more. He's moved in. He may be like Phil and have a better second half, latter half of his career than he ever did in his youth.
Yeah, he could end up like Vijay Singh, too, who in his 40s won 20-something tournaments, 22 tournaments. Sergio could do that, but he's not a great putter, and you have to do three things. He's a great driver of the golf ball, which you have to be. He's a terrific wedge player, but Sergio's not a great putter. And I think that, in the end, is going to be his Achilles heel. Vijay was a terrific putter in his 40s. And, you know, that's really, in the end, it always comes down to the putt. So I was happy for Sergio to get that monkey off his back. I think Westwood probably wasn't so happy because now the monkey's on Westwood's back as the greatest player not to win a major title. But I think the whole golf world was happy to see Sergio do that. These guys are all Masters champions. Adam Scott is another guy. And I think Bubba Watson is still really I think he still has great desire to be a terrific player, and I think he's still determined and disciplined, and you know, those guys should be in contention at this U.S. Open. It's a unique golf course. I feel it's a bomber's paradise and a high ball hitter's paradise, and those guys all fit that bill.
Another grouping, Steve Stricker and Stuart Sink playing alongside Phil Mickelson. The course would probably play well for Phil, but he may not be there because of his daughter's high school graduation. What do you think of that?
It's hard to believe that somebody dropped the ball on that and missed the conflict. You know, I mean, it's not like you didn't know when the U.S. Open was going to be. That was announced in 2010, and it's just a real sad oversight. And he's only, if he doesn't play, Mickelson's only missing this U.S. Open by a couple of hours. He's got his own private airplane. He can get there, but he can't get there in time to see or to play the U.S. Open because of his daughter's graduation. If that's the case, then he should stay. And, you know, his daughter's valedictorian. She's going to speak this year. So it's a big deal. It's a big graduation. But this was easily avoided. I think the high school would have gladly moved it up 2 hours so that Phil could make his tee time. The USGA is doing everything they can. Now there's a petition for the high school to change the time of the graduation so that Phil can play in the U.S. Open. But you got to believe that Phil circled every U.S. Open date on his calendar until he's 60 years old. And it's just a sad oversight if he's not able to make it.
You know, as much as you call it a sad oversight, it's kind of inspirational to me. I respect his choice here. I think some athletes may go play golf and record the high school graduation. This makes me like Phil.
Well, you know, there's not a lot of reasons not to like Phil. He's one of the most likable people you'd ever meet. And it's I think, an easy decision for a golfer, probably for any athlete. I mean, I don't know if you'd miss the seventh game of an NBA Finals to go see your daughter's graduation, but you might. You know, I think as a parent, it's an easy decision for Phil Mickelson to skip the U.S. Open if he can't do both. But I think it's also just as easy for Phil to have been able to do both.
All right, let's circle back to Tiger Woods, the elephant in the room. You always have to talk about Tiger Woods, obviously recently arrested for driving under the influence of something. Do you think this is the end of Tiger Woods as a public figure and as a competitive golfer?
No, I don't think either could be the end. But I do think that somebody needs to intervene and that, you know, this opiate epidemic is a big deal. And if he's hooked on anything like a Vicodin or anything like that, that can be a death sentence for a guy. And I think that Tiger, you know, he may be looking at rehab if he is hooked on something like that, or if it was just a mistake, then, you know, that's not as big an issue. But those pills kill. And I'm really more worried about Tiger as a man, as a person, as a father, than I am about his golf career. His golf career, if Tiger's pain-free, he's only 40. If he's pain-free, I wouldn't rule him out because I saw Tiger in his prime. I know what he can do. But I'm more concerned about his overall well-being. And if he's got an addiction problem, it's better be addressed or, you know, we may not have him around.
We're joined by Paul Azinger. Paul, in the golf world, I don't want to single it out just to you. In the golf world where guys – are people in the golf world not surprised by this? They knew there was potentially some issue with Tiger?
I know firsthand there's some players that think there's a problem there with Tiger. I don't. I haven't been around him much in the last few years, but there are some players out there that are saying this has been a problem for a while. And, you know, Tiger's close to a few people, not many. And the few people that are around Tiger probably know there's a problem. And if they don't intervene, then you know, it's on them. But addiction's a big deal, and if he's addicted, then somebody better intervene.
You mentioned Tiger's background is so unique compared to almost any athlete, but almost any golfer in terms of, he's been in the spotlight for such a young age. And so he reminds me of a child television star, that this is what goes along with the baggage of being a celebrity at a very young age. He didn't even choose golf. His dad chose it for him. Tiger has to be held accountable and responsible, but I have a lot of sympathy for Tiger.
Yeah, I do too. I mean, he's had a lot of back surgeries. He's had knee surgeries. He's had an Achilles issue. He's had a lot of pain. It would be easy for Tiger to get hooked on that. That's very addictive drug if he's hooked on it. I hope he's not. I don't believe anybody forced Tiger to play golf. I think he made that choice. His dad led him that direction because his dad loved the game of golf. But nothing came easy for Tiger. Tiger earned everything he ever got. You know, you got to grind to make those putts, you know, when they matter most. And I give him a lot of credit for being the best mentally of anybody that's played in our era, really since Jack Nicklaus. And, you know, I miss him. I hope he can, you know, turn his life around first and then see if he's got another, you know, second gear here or another gear to try to play some decent golf again.
All right, I'm a degenerate gambler. I don't hide it. I'm going to Las Vegas probably this weekend. Give me two or three picks. Who do you like in this U.S. Open? Give me two or three guys you like.
Well, I know if you're a degenerate gambler, you probably like good odds. So I'd go with somebody like a Kevin Kisner. He's got a great swing and should have a lot of confidence. He'll probably go off. I see you writing that down.
Yeah.
He'll probably go off at 25 or 35 to 1 or something like that. If you're a guy that likes to play favorites, then I think you're going to have to play the big hitters. It's a bomber's paradise. The fairways are fairly wide. And there's a lot of blind shots here or semi-blind shots at this golf course. And a lot of the second shots into the greens are going to be above the player. So you got to have a high ball hitter. And I would look for all the great high ball hitters, the, you know, Adam Scott types, guys like Matsuyama, who hits it really, really high. Of course, Dustin Johnson. These guys are not going to, you know, they're going to go off at little tougher odds for you. But it's hard. You know, I wouldn't bet on anybody that doesn't go off at like 8 to 1. I mean, if somebody's less than 8 to 1.
So you're not a degenerate. I like long shots.
No, I mean, I'd go long shots. But like Tiger was going off even money in his prime.
Yeah.
But I would say that the favorite probably is not going off better than 8 to 1. And that to me is always a, you know, that's probably a hard bet even at 8 to 1. I don't know how anybody bet on Tiger at even money, but they did. And he probably paid big dividends for a lot of guys. Jason Day hits it a mile high. So does McIlroy and Justin Rose. And those guys are proven winners. They know how to get it done. And I think they're going to like the golf course. I see John Rahm on there. There's a great article about John Rahm out right now. If you Google him and just hit news, you'll be able to read that story. His work ethic and the way he thinks and the way he plays is unique to somebody his age at age 22. And he hits it a mile. And I think Rahm is, unless there's just too much attention and it distracts him and puts too much pressure on, he should be a guy that gets in contention at this U.S. Open and a lot for the next 20 years.